Okay, welcome everyone. Thanks for coming today. I'm really excited to be introducing today's speaker. Naomi Starkman is founder and the editor-in-chief of Civil Eats. Civil Eats is a news site devoted to promoting sustainable and just food system. It was named Publication of the Year by the James Beard Foundation in 2014. And if you want to check it out, head to civileats.com. Last year, Naomi was a John S. Knight Journalism Fellow at Stanford. She has also served as the Director of Communications and Policy at Slow Food Nation, and has worked as a media consultant at Newsweek, The New Yorker, Vanity Fair, GQ, Wired. Previously, she was the Director of Communications at the American Foundation for AIDS Research, and after graduating from law school, among many other achievements, she served as the Deputy Executive Director of San Francisco's Ethics Commission. She's an avid organic gardener, and she currently resides right here in Sonoma County. So please join me in welcoming Naomi Starkman.
Hi, you guys. Thanks so much for spending your lunch hour with me. Do you guys sit all day in school? Do you want to like stand up? Let's just stand up for a second. Everybody stand up. I know it's really annoying when people do this. But let's just stand up for 1 second and just like shake it out. Shake it out. Okay. Take a deep breath. Sit back down. We're going to talk a little bit about food and agriculture. How many here consider themselves foodies? 2 hands. How many of you consider yourself farmies, more interested in the farm world? 2 hands. How many of you are just happy if you get something to eat? Lots of hands. Okay. So what if I asked you guys whether you wanted to be part of a movement that is totally passionate, but also totally incoherent and leaderless? How many of you would raise your hands? Yeah, so a few brave people. What if I told you that you were already part of this movement? You're part of it when you ask for more truth and trust and transparency in the food system. You're part of it when you demand better, clean, fair food for all. And you're part of it when you vote with your wallet at farmers markets and healthy food stores. In fact, you guys are part of this phenomenon called the Good Food Movement. Now, some of you may be surprised to hear that you're part of a movement. You didn't sign up for it. You don't maybe remember talking about it. But others of you, especially the students in this room, you might know you're part of it. You probably have grown up in it. And you're a key driving force. And maybe you didn't always feel this way. I certainly didn't. And I want to share with you today how I woke up to the fact that food connects us all, that it touches every part of our lives, that it's a true connector. And I remember the exact moment when I woke up to the fact that food really does drive everything. I was working at the New Yorker magazine at the time, and we had this incredible farm-to-chef event. And these chefs were there, and this table was laden high with the bounty of a farm's goods. And this light bulb went on, and I asked myself, what is the story behind this glorious food? And not just how it tasted, because it was certainly delicious, but what was its story? And this desire to follow the story was so commanding that it led me from a high-rise building in the middle of Times Square in New York City down a dirty, bumpy road to the career that I now have almost a decade later. While I was having this awakening, I started to look around and I started realizing that I wasn't the only one. The entire nation was having an awakening too. People were waking up to food. The country was transforming and a conversation was starting around a better food system. Some might even say that we started having a good food revolution. These photographs are by Douglas Gaetan. He is a Petaluma resident. He is a great photographer. If you ever have a chance to look at his work, I highly recommend him. It's at the Lexicon Project. We are so lucky to live in Sonoma County. Just this past week, there was an article in a local Petaluma paper talking about the bounty of Sonoma County. And the Sonoma County Farm Bureau executive director said that there are very few places on earth, like Sonoma County, where there's so many opportunities for people to plug in around food. So how many of you go to the local farmers market? Cotati, Santa Rosa, Petaluma, Rohnert Park, Sebastopol. We have so many farmers markets here. And you probably have a strategy about how you go to the farmers market, get your bags, you have your list, you have your cash, you probably even have a few of your favorite farmers that you strategize and that you're gonna get there. And you probably have relationships with these farmers. You probably go there and you ask them questions and you find out, how do you grow your food? And maybe you go to the farmers market not just for the delicious food, but for the collective sense of community. You guys might not know this, but you have on average 10 times the number of conversations at a farmers market than you do at a supermarket. So there's a human connection around food that keeps us invested. There's something there for us all, feeding us, nourishing us. And when you get home, maybe you share your bounty with your friends and your family with the added benefit of knowing that you're keeping your dollars in the local economy. This experience is happening everywhere in the United States. In the past decade alone, the number of farmers markets has exploded by 180%. There are now more than 9,000 farmers markets in the United States. And there's more evidence of a growing food movement. Between 2006 and 2012, there was a 430% increase in farm-to-school programs, reaching more than 4,000 schools across the country with locally sourced food from farms. During that same time, the number of regional food hubs that connect farmers with wholesale, retail, institutional buyers grew by almost 300%. Here's a description of a regional food hub. So there's an institutional purchaser, there are hospitals, universities, schools, and farmers who are selling directly into these food hubs. And you guys know this because young people in particular are driving this movement and defining it with their interest in agroecology and their demand for a better food system. Moving corporations faster than regulations on issues like removing or reducing antibiotics in our meat supply, scaling up cage-free eggs, and demanding less processed artificial ingredients from companies across the board. As a result, the U.S. organic industry reached a record $43 billion last year. And as interest in the food rises, interest in a better food system rises, their market share in conventional and processed food is sinking. The top 25 U.S. food and beverage companies lost an equivalent of $18 billion in market share since 2009. They are really feeling it. This kind of transformation doesn't just happen. It's happening because of a result of concerted effort of thousands of dedicated advocates, activists, and community-based organizations working to change our food system. And they're not just doing it through their purchasing decisions, but also by holding elected officials accountable and demanding better food policy at local, state, and national levels. This growing interest in food is the realization that food so strongly intersects with and can develop collective solutions to some of the most critical societal issues of our time, including persistent hunger and obesity, climate change and environmental degradation, and labor exploitation and concentration of capital. People all around the country are building community through food together. When we break bread, when we share our triumphs, we share our dreams, and we try to also solve our disagreements. Together, through food, we find love. In the last decade, there has been so much more that has developed than just the soaring demand and where our food comes from. People are starting to ask how our food is being produced and by whom. And today I'm going to talk to you about some of those parts of the food system that have been developing but often go unreported. I want to introduce you to some people in the food movement who inspire me and I hope will inspire you. I consider them the foot soldiers on the front lines of the food movement. And you may recognize some, but some are lesser known champions and unsung heroes. I'll also talk about some simple actions we can all take to make a difference. So to begin, let's look at the driving force behind the food movement. One of the most significant ways the food movement has developed in the 10 years since Michael Pollan wrote Omnivore's Dilemma has been this rising awareness and key political successes of food and farm workers, without whom we would simply not have food. Michael Pollan said he didn't discuss labor in his book at that time, which he notes is much more about the eater and much less about the person behind the food or the producer. So while the food movement has emerged as a cultural and economic counterforce to industrialized agriculture, critics have claimed that good food is elitist and accessible only to those who can afford it. And for a long time, the conversation has not been inclusive, nor has it been about equity or access or justice. Today, I want to start by talking about those issues, and I want to put a face on the overlooked and yet incredibly important members of the food movement who grow, produce, and prepare our food. To bring things into current context, the American food system relies on immigrant labor more than any other cross-section of the economy. Now, you all know and you've heard Trump's rhetoric about immigration, and while there's still a moving target about what's going to actually happen, there are an estimated 11 million undocumented immigrants in this country, many of whom work in agriculture. There are about 2.5 million U.S. farm and ag workers, and the estimates vary greatly about how many are undocumented, but many think it's as much as 70%. Around 20% of unauthorized immigrants work in meat processing and food service jobs, including waiting tables, washing dishes, and other restaurant and food prep services. There are so many questions about who will grow our food and what will happen to these people who are such a critical part of the fabric of our society. In the meantime, a few actions are taking place, like the nationwide sanctuary restaurant movement. I don't know if any of you have heard about this. It's different than sanctuary cities. Some of you might know that the Sonoma County Board of Supervisors sort of gave a nod to having Sonoma County cities be sanctuary cities. Sanctuary restaurants are actually restaurants where the chefs and proprietors are deciding that they are going to protect their workers and help them on a path towards citizenship. So far, there are hundreds of restaurants that have signed on nationally, and the sanctuary restaurant movement has firmly taken hold in the Bay Area in particular, with about 50 restaurants in the greater Bay Area participating. In Sonoma County, Zazu Kitchen and Farm in Sebastopol and Epicurean Connection in Sonoma have registered as sanctuary restaurants. And some high-profile chefs are stepping up to support their staff and support their activism, including a recent Day Without Immigrants, and there'll be another one on May Day, which is next Monday, when a lot of restaurants and shops are closing. So you can understand just from understanding and living in this county and hearing the numbers what's at stake with food and farm workers in the current political landscape. Some believe that the successes of food and farm workers have picked up on the work of Cesar Chavez. Many of you are familiar with Cesar Chavez. He was a Mexican-American farm worker, and he became the best-known Latino-American civil rights activist. Chavez co-founded the National Farm Workers Association, which later became the United Farm Workers Union, with Dolores Huerta in 1962. His approach to unionism and nonviolent tactics made the farm worker struggle a moral cause, which gained nationwide support. And farm workers did gain some benefits and significant rights thanks to the UFW. But today, many are still working long hours under brutal conditions for very little pay. Now, in this greater era of consciousness around food, there are new groups stepping into Chavez's shoes. And because of their efforts, there are bright spots around the country where fair wages and working conditions for food and farm workers are gaining ground. I want to introduce you to some farm workers who have been successful in having their rights met. This is Lucas Benitez and Greg Asbed of the Coalition of Immokalee Workers out of Florida. It's a worker-based human rights organization, and they have been incredibly successful in negotiating with major brands for a penny per pound more for tomatoes. Now, a penny per pound may sound like a pittance, but it represents a 50% raise, the difference between making $50 a day and $80 a day. these guys and their entire team are following in the footsteps of Chavez and helping to bring awareness, not about just how your food is grown, but by whom. In addition to farm laborers, there are about 21 million people working in the five sectors of the food chain, from production to processing to distribution, retail, and service. Saru Jayaraman is a co-founder and co-director of Restaurant Opportunities Center United and director of the Food Labor Research Center at UC Berkeley. Saru is a radical advocate for transformation of our nation's restaurants. She has led campaigns against some of the largest and most powerful lobbying groups in the country in order to win fair wages and better working conditions for restaurant workers. Why is that important? Well, first of all, seven of the 10 lowest paying jobs in America are in food. Since 2009, the federal minimum wage has been stuck at $7.25 an hour. Low-wage workers are actually worse off now than they were in 1968, when the minimum wage reached a peak of $8.56 an hour in inflation-adjusted dollars. Saru is putting a face on the struggles and fighting the fight for 15 for an increased minimum wage, and she's succeeding. As a result of their work, at least 40 U.S. cities and states advance minimum wage hikes that go into effect this year. And there are so many champions like Saru and the Coalition of Immokalee Workers. This is Melanie Gleason, and she is such a hero to me. She's a lawyer who kickstarted her own campaign to drive around in her smart car to offer her legal immigration services to farm workers for free. She has a new business called Attorney on the Move, and she has since moved to the border between Mexico to focus solely on the issues around immigration. And here she is driving up to a field and offering many people who don't even know that they have rights free legal advice. So I told you how I had an awakening and how I had this incredible moment when the light went on. I told you how I got interested in food and farming and that I let my high-rise media job and I went down that bumpy dirt road. But I didn't tell you something else. I did something I never thought I would do. I actually became a farmer. That's me in the bottom right. I spent several years working on U.S. farms, and I had some of the most deeply rooted experiences of my life. And I learned what it means to grow food organically, sustainably. I earned what's called my dirt cred. I also realized that farming is the hardest job there is. I often call it faith-based work because you plant food in the ground and you actually don't know if it's going to grow. Farming became a form of salvation for me. It became a sense of hope, a place where I connected with my community. And farming becomes a sense of salvation to many people. In fact, there are many studies that show that just putting your hands in the dirt has real physiological benefits on your mental health and on your well-being. Many believe that the soil can literally save us. And for many people, it has literally been a saving grace. For those veterans who return home from war, for those who are homeless, and for those who are the formerly incarcerated, farming has literally been life-saving. And I want to share a few of their stories. This is Michael O'Gorman. He is the founding executive director of the Farmer Veterans Coalition, which is based in Davis, and he helps returning veterans become farmers at a time when the average age of the American farmer is 58. His work has helped hundreds of vets go from fighting in the fields to plowing in the fields. He helped Kelly Carlisle return home from working in Iraq to start her predominantly African-American venture, which is called Acta Non Verba, a youth urban farm project, which is now in the inner cities of Oakland, California, where she grew up. So now we can thank our veterans not only for serving our country, but their willingness to be our farmers. In a much maligned segment of society, the formerly incarcerated face a daunting set of challenges, finding a job, a place to live, and developing new skills. The good news is that many are finding new starts, as well as rehabilitation and salvation through the restorative qualities that working in gardens and food can offer. One such amazing garden is in West Oakland. It was started by the former founder of the Black Panthers, Elaine Brown. It's called West Oakland Farms. It's truly an amazing project, and it just demonstrates how farming can bring about a renaissance in an under-resourced neighborhood. Not only is farming helping so many to start, get a new foot, it's also helping at-risk youth. This is the Snow Day Food Truck, which calls itself a vehicle for social justice, and it's the first of its kind. It's giving formerly incarcerated youth in New York City a path forward toward better lives. It trains kids in all aspects of food service, and it gives them all sorts of lifelong job skills. In New York City, about 70% of former convicts get arrested, incarcerated, or convicted of a new crime. Snow Day hopes to bring those numbers down to 20%. And it's doing that by investing in young people who feel like they're part of something that's positive. Customers who go there for lunch realize that your lunch can be something that's quite dramatic and a force for good. There are other organizations stepping up to offer training and assistance, and some of them are big food companies. You might know some of these names: Pop Gourmet Foods, Dave's Killer Bread, Grayston Bakery. All of these companies are helping to train the formerly incarcerated, seeking people out to give them new lifelong skills in food. So let's talk a little bit about the future. I want to talk to you a little bit about the importance of good food in school lunch and the progress being made. But before I do that, I want to share with you my own experience in watching kids learn how to love food. When I farmed, I often hosted groups of kids from the inner city, and no matter their zip code, they would show up at the farm and invariably ask the same questions. Why is there dirt all over your vegetables? Is chicken meat? They just had lost their connection to food, and maybe they never had it, because so many of us are so disconnected, and many of us haven't been connected for a long time. I've seen firsthand when kids who'd barely get out of the car, refusing to go down the field, would then race through the field to shuck corn and pull carrots and have a sense of joy about their food. Seeing kids really transform around the taste of that carrot is pretty cool. Kids connect to what's visceral, and they can taste and touch, and that's why Chef Alice Waters has called the good food movement a delicious revolution. We want to get kids by their taste buds. So getting kids off to the right start is so important. Nationally, 1 in 5 school kids is obese, and nearly 1 in 4 teens has diabetes or pre-diabetes. So school cafeterias have become the front lines of feeding America's kids, and they play a huge role in the health and nutrition of our future. More than 30 million children rely on the National School Lunch Program, and roughly half of those children also take part in the School Breakfast Program, a free program for kids in need. School food is a $16.3 billion industry, and it's this use of public dollars which creates both an important opportunity and a responsibility for our kids. There are so many reasons why healthy school food is critical. Healthy school food improves nutrition and good health. Healthy school food protects our most vulnerable children against hunger. Healthy school food prevents obesity and creates lifelong good eating habits. So I want to talk with you a little bit about some champions of good food helping to shape the way our children eat. Some of these people you might have already heard of, but there are some that I hope you have not. I'm sure many of you are familiar with our former First Lady, Michelle Obama, and she really put school food on the national map when she launched Let's Move, her hallmark program to end childhood obesity in 2010. She championed the transformation of school food and helped update school meal nutrition standards for the first time in 15 years and increased its funding for the first time in 3 decades. Now American public school kids have healthier school meals and snacks, and that's 50 million kids whose lives she's touched. In addition to her leadership, the former First Lady managed to influence food policy and eating habits throughout so many of her actions, giving America's food movement a much-needed boost. The White House garden, in which she's pictured here, was the first planted there since Eleanor Roosevelt's Victory Garden, and it helped promote the benefits of fresh and local produce and helped children to appreciate where their food comes from. The good news is that Melania Trump is apparently going to keep the garden. Very happy about that. Michelle Obama also championed healthy living and exercise, and she worked with the food industry to remove calories from the food supply, increasing transparency in their labeling, and creating and marketing healthier food choices for families, efforts that have already had impacts and will continue to do so. At the latest count, the group has already removed an astonishing amount of calories from Pepsi, Coke, and General Mills. We're talking about 6.4 trillion calories, or 78 calories per person, just by reformulating products and shrinking serving sizes. And there's somebody else who's worked incredibly hard to bring school food to the national forefront. And she's right here in our backyard. For decades, we in California have pioneered the way towards healthier school lunch, led by the legendary chef Alice Waters of famed nearby Berkeley restaurant Chez Panisse. Alice developed the Edible Schoolyard Project to help schools around the country integrate garden and cooking into the schoolroom. 20 years later, it hosts a network of over 5,000 programs in all 50 states and 57 countries, feeding more than 9 million students. Waters, who has long believed that we do have the courage and conviction to establish a nutritious, sustainable, free school lunch program for all, is a true lunch lady reformer, and she believes the Berkeley model can be the nation's model. 3 years ago, she was named one of Time Magazine's 100 Most Influential People, and she wrote, quote, "By radically changing the way we think about feeding our children, we not only change the nutrition of individual children and the diet of all Americans in a generation, we also restore the health of the land and the essential values of this country." You know Michelle Obama's work, and now you know a little bit more about Alice Waters' work. I also want to introduce you to one of my personal heroes. Her name is Betty Wiggins. Betty, until recently, was the director of the school nutrition program at Detroit Public Schools, and she had the responsibility of feeding 55,000 kids in 141 schools in that district. Under her leadership over the past 5 years, school meals in Detroit have completely transformed. Gone are chicken nuggets and sugary drinks. School cafeterias now serve fresh fruit and mixed baby greens from local farmers, and lean meats and low-fat milk and whole grain bread. Many serve produce from gardens right on their own campuses. And because of Betty, that school district became the first in the country to offer free breakfast to every student regardless of their income. I asked Betty how she's been so successful when so many people who try to reform school lunch fail. And she said, "I'm not successful. It's one of the biggest challenges. How did school food become so politicized?" And she said the only way to combat this is for everyone, whether you have kids or not, to get involved to ensure that the future of this country are well fed. Betty said, quote, "I truly believe we are changing the food system and ensuring that our students and community have more than a consumer relationship with food." And I think she's right. There's so much at stake with the school lunch program. And if you care about the future of our kids, I urge you to keep your eye on that story. So we've seen how partnerships and persistence connects school food reformers to their community. It's also what brought the food and farm worker community to the forefront of the food movement. And it's also the connective tissue rehabilitating vulnerable populations. So since you now are all part of this food movement, I want to talk about simple ways you can get involved and become a champion too. You can get localized. This is Catherine. She runs the Sarah's Community Project right here in Sebastopol. I write about a lot of things nationally. I've been so impressed by the community center at Sarah's that I have actually written about them twice, and she was recently featured as a CNN hero. She started this program to teach youth not only how to cook, but to work in gardens and train them to prepare meals for people who are chronically sick in Sonoma County. So anybody in Sonoma County who has a life-threatening disease can get this wholesome, delicious, nutritious food prepared by these kids and delivered to them. And the whole cycle of community around food is one of the most inspiring things I've ever seen. They're right in Sebastopol, and you can go check out their garden. In addition to Sarah's Community Project, there's Daily Acts. They're based in Petaluma, They do amazing amount of work. They teach people how to replace their lawns and put in food forests, as they call them. They have right now this community resilience challenge, which is going on. It's an annual community mobilization. This is what it looks like. If you Google it online, you can join right now. There are all sorts of actions happening through April and now into May to save water and grow food and conserve energy, reduce waste, and build community. There's also the Farmers Guild, which is based in Sebastopol. This is run by Evan Wigg, who's a young, inspiring farmer, and he helps young people who want to go back to the land really connect and get wisdom from their elders. And he's improving the chances of young people staying on the farm by cultivating their social and professional presence in agriculture. These are just some local examples, and they're just three of so many in ways which you guys can get plugged in. If you don't already, it looks like a lot of you already do shop at your local farmers market. You can join a community-supported agriculture program, and wherever possible, support your local food economy. Some of you probably know this because you probably are at Olivers all the time, but Olivers has a really cool program that skews for local. So when you get your receipt at the end of shopping, you can see how many dollars you're actually spending on products that are local products. I think it's really a great focus that Olivers has. There are also local food initiatives here on campus. I've been told there is a campus-run organic garden and food services, and you can get involved in any program that's happening through the Real Food Challenge, which is a nationwide organization that focuses on college campuses. When you shop at the farmers market, one of the most important things you can do is ask your farmer how she grows her food. Ask what chemicals are being applied. Ask her how the workers are treated. Ask how the farm, where the farm is. Ask as many questions as you can, because your participation in the food system is demanded. You're a co-producer in the food system. So I've shared with you a little bit about my own experience and my own coming to food, and I really do believe that there's a deep connection that builds community through food and revitalizing marginalized and vulnerable communities who are most impacted by the food system. The stories that I shared with you today are just a drop in the bucket of what we cover at Civil Eats, and they really underscore that equity and access to healthy food is a right and not a privilege. Participating in our food system is required if we want to see greater change. And I truly believe that each of you in this room is a co-participant in our food system, and yes, a member of the food movement. It's this human connection which will sustain us, and it's my greatest passion and purpose to share these stories with you. I'd like to end by sharing this quote with you guys from Cesar Chavez. If you really want to make a friend, go to someone's house and eat with them. The people who give you their food give you their heart. Happy to take any of your questions. So many of you know about genetically modified food. Anybody in here, is that a non-familiar term? Everybody's pretty familiar. So genetically engineered food or genetically modified food, it's different, obviously, than food that's been like a hybrid food. It actually has a novel, engineered, oftentimes different product put into the actual crop. Some of them are actually engineered to withstand pesticides that are actually applied by the same companies, and they're owned by some of the largest agri companies and agribiz companies in the world. So Monsanto, Syngenta, Bayer, other big companies. A lot of these companies are trying to merge. And so one of the biggest challenges around GMOs is that they're not labeled. We have finally, after many years, a national standard that's still on hold right now given the new administration that would require and mandate labeling of GMOs, but without saying it. So in other words, you'd have to have a cell phone to scan a code that would have like a QR code. So the labeling of GMOs, which we had an initiative in California to mandate, which didn't pass, has been one of the biggest issues since 60 countries in the world do label GMOs. And what's sort of at stake is not only what we're eating, we don't have enough medical research to actually show that there are negative health impacts, but we have plenty of research that shows that there are very severe environmental impacts, ergo very severe human impact. And kind of unwrapping the GMO question is pretty important. I think GMOs need much greater study. They need to be studied by universities that are not land-grant universities that receive money from some of the largest chemical companies. A lot of the studies are supported and given financial support by some of the larger agribiz companies. So independent science still needs to be done. But in the meantime, what we're seeing right now with a lot of GMOs, especially around the environmental impacts, are it's what's being called a pesticide treadmill. So in the beginning, they were sort of touted as being a way to feed the world, and now we're seeing it actually create greater and greater pesticide resistance, so farmers are having to use more and more. It's pretty complicated. We have a whole section on our site around GMOs, which you're free to kind of peruse, but it's sort of taken a back burner issue right now because we have so many other problems, especially around pesticides in this country.
So Naomi, thank you very much. Really great presentation. It gives me heart. And I listened to something recently about seed banks and how some of those large corporate entities, you know, want to control the seeds. And you know, this seed feels really powerful, maybe because it's Sonoma County. But do you feel like we have a chance?
I am always hopeful. I'm a short-term pessimist and a long-term optimist, because I don't think you could do this work if you weren't an optimist. We just partnered with ITBIS. There's a film last week on PBS, I don't know if any of you saw, called Seed, The Untold Story. You can still download that and watch it. It's such a great film. And we did some reporting around that to talk to some of the issues you're raising, which is the massive conglomerates who are buying up many of the world's seeds. One story we did was on a novel technology called CRISPR, which is sort of the next generation of GMOs. And the other was on sort of this open seed saving and sourcing through OSSI. So there are two things happening. There are, to her point too, of like this, these mega companies that are coming together to sort of own all of the seeds and patent seeds, which Monsanto has done. And then there's this rising kind of counterinsurgents where people are saying, no, seeds are our very life form and we should have access to them. We should be able to save seed. California just recently passed a law making seed saving legal. Many people didn't know that seed saving and seed swapping was illegal. It still is in many states. So how do we kind of turn the tide to have more community resilience around seeds that feels more part of our collective future? You have to have some hope. I think Sonoma County is a very unique place in that regard because we're very conscious here. And hopefully with the seed bank in Petaluma and other places that are really trying to demonstrate the importance of seed saving, we'll hopefully make small but important steps.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Is there like a same type of effort trying, an effort being made towards cleaner, like poultry being sold, and like mm-hmm. I know there's like poultry that are like injected with like salt water to make them bigger.
So yeah, I mean chicken is one of the most complicated meats being produced in the United States. We eat more chicken than any other meat, and the way that we produce chickens, largely in factory farms, is pretty horrific. So there's an animal welfare component to it as well. And in order to keep chickens in these cramped conditions, we feed them antibiotics. Most of the antibiotics we feed chickens and also cattle, almost 80% of it are actually human-grade antibiotics. And we're keeping animals in these very cramped and filthy conditions so that we can produce very cheap meat, but there's a very high cost. And so there's been a lot of consumer pressure on changing the chicken market. And just recently, of all places, Kentucky Fried Chicken said they were going to make a huge effort to reduce and, in fact, remove antibiotics from their food chain. So it's just one of those very small but important examples of how your power as a consumer can make a difference. In fact, make a difference more so than even the regulatory agencies that don't demand that antibiotics be removed. It's always been voluntary for chicken farmers and beef farmers and industrial animal agriculture in general. The example you gave about injecting water, that's still a practice that a lot of chicken producers do. It plumps up the chicken breast, they can weigh more. There's absolutely no benefit to anybody for that. Consumer Reports, Consumers Union, has some really great information about which producers actually do that, so you could Google that if you wanted to know which producers are pumping their chicken full of water.
Thank you.
started reading the China study and the implications about the effects of animal-based protein and the environmental hazards of producing and being able to feed and resource all the livestock. So for these food movements, would you say it's, you know, perspective on both vegetation quality and animal welfare, but as well as do you see any movements in less consumption of animal-based protein and more plant-based, or like how people choose to, or just having better quality of treatment overall, how the food is processed and dispersed among people?
Those are great questions, and it's really both, right?
Yeah.
So we have people who come to our site who are self kind of described vegans,
yeah,
who don't believe that there's any amount of ethical, high welfare animal production that would make eating animals ethical. And then we have people who are animal agriculture, high welfare producers, whose goal is to remove the suffering of animals, but also produce a product that people still want to eat. And so the way that I see it and the way that we write about it is, you know, meat eating is on a spectrum. And on one end is factory farming, and on the other end is being a vegan. And our experience has been that very few people are over here. But we want to move people from here. For all the reasons that you state, it's not just a public health crisis. It's also an environmental crisis. It's a climate change crisis. Animal agriculture contributes greatly to climate change. So all those factors are coming together, and we had a great piece recently about how, like, the very high welfare, slow food people are at war with the vegans. And actually, they want the same thing. They want a better food system. They want animals to be treated better. They want a better food system for animals. So, and there are plenty of people who work in high animal welfare who believe that animals are part of the solution because they are regenerative to the soil. I don't think it's an either-or equation. I really do think that all solutions have to be on the table, but I'm really, really glad you asked that question. For those of you who aren't familiar, the China study, which he just referred to, is one of the longest studies that looks at the consumption of animal protein in the human diet, and comes out pretty starkly against it. I mean, many people think it's pretty radical, but it's very evidence-based.
I was wondering if you noticed any universities that have been able to transform the way that they do their landscaping, where they're not spending so much money on ornamental plants and start growing food.
Mm-hmm.
I've worked on the landscape department here for almost 17 years, and I've seen millions and millions of dollars that have been spent on ornamental plants, and I believe that if we would start growing more fruit trees, and they could be beautiful and produce something that would feed the community. I planted an orange tree over there by Bacon and Eggs, which is
mm-hmm.
in the center of campus,
mm-hmm.
and it's blooming right now. It smells wonderful. And have you run into any?
That's a great story.
Inviting to university?
No, I mean, I haven't heard that in particular. I mean, there are universities that have college campus gardens.
Mm-hmm.
Like, I was at Stanford last year, and they have this incredible farm, really, on the campus. But the notion, this is actually what Daily Acts does, right, which is to replace ornamental with edibles. And what a great idea. And it would be educational, and it would give back so much. And I'm going to look into it. And I'm glad you're doing that. I want to go check out your orange tree. Any other questions?
I noticed the farmers markets honor food stamps and even double them.
Yes.
And what do you think about changing food stamps so they only apply to fresh produce and not processed foods?
That is a very complicated question. I want to address the first part of what you said. So, and just share with everybody that one of the best projects right now, one of the most hopeful projects I see, is this notion of doubling up your bucks at farmers markets. So farmers markets across the United States that are participating in this program, if you have SNAP, which is formerly known as food stamps, you can get double your value if you're buying fresh food and produce, which is fresh fruit and produce and vegetables. So the idea of incentivizing better health. And there's an organization in the States called Wholesome Way that has largely been behind this effort. And EBT is being accepted now for use of food stamps or SNAP at farmers markets. So it's an incredibly important way to actually get people to eat more fresh fruits and vegetables. There are state initiatives to do what you're suggesting, which is basically not allow any other type of food other than fresh fruits and vegetables under food stamps. I think there are plenty of people in the hunger community, which itself is actually very divided, that would disagree with that approach, simply because people who need food stamps need to buy what they need to buy, and they're going to need to buy perhaps flour and rice and beans and pasta and other food stuff. So I don't see that actually ever coming to be, but it's being tried, like outlawing things like sugary drinks and snack foods or junk food. It's been, some states are slowly kind of edging towards that.
Are there other local or statewide policies that we should be keeping an eye out for that are on the horizon?
So many. There are so many that relate to climate change and to farmers. There are is a great piece of legislation right now that will hopefully help introduce and support urban agriculture. There's also great legislation that would helpfully reduce the debt of young farmers, because a lot of young farmers are coming out of college and they can't actually sustain themselves because they have college debt. On the federal level, there's so much that's uncertain right now on the federal level that I hesitate to even kind of try to have any foresight. On the statewide level, there's legislation, there's a Healthy Soil Initiative that basically promotes farms to do better and be better. There's a new legislation that was just introduced about looking at justice in the farm worker world. So yeah, there's a ton, and there's a great organization called Roots of Change. Michael Dimmick, who lives in Santa Rosa, who'd be a great speaker too, is one of the best about statewide food policy issues. Any other last burning questions on food? Yes.
Yeah, hi there. How can we as a group or individuals help spread more awareness towards this movement?
So you guys are the best indicators of change, because young people are the face of this movement, and you guys are so peer-oriented that most of the research I'm seeing is simply by acting and being the way you want to be and sharing that with your friend circle. A lot of the changes, like with chicken and other things, are coming because people are coming together and then as a group demanding more change. So if we're lucky enough, we get to eat 3 times a day. You get the power purchase of your pocketbook to decide what food system you want to buy into, and your friends are going to see that. So just start talking with your friends and family. And I'll tell you, just after having done this work for such a long time, people always come to the table with more honey than vinegar. People don't want to be lectured at, they don't want to be blamed, they don't want to be shamed, they just want information. And then I always let people make their own decision. At the end of the day, food is such a connector and not a divider, that even if you just sit down and you make food, like maybe let's say you make one of your favorite meals for somebody, you can change their mind over a meal. That's where I would start.
I think we're out of time.
Okay.
Thank you very much.
Thank you guys.